We were seeing an example of how to specify the end effector position and orientation for a specific task. So today what we'll do is complete that example. Then we will look at the following very important concept of how to define parameters of a mechanism. We will see an example in this particular case. There is a particular transformation which is useful, which is used when we do the inverse and forward kinematics, which uses a way we set up the reference frames on the links. So we will see that transformation too. So let us start with the example we saw. The problem was the following. There is a part placed on this table which has to be picked up by an end effector, a gripper, and transferred to this particular position where the pegs of this part would go into the holes which are there on this part, right. So it has to be brought to this position and assembled. So if you remember, we had set up some reference frames in order to specify this particular various positions. One was we fixed the reference frame x1, y1, z1 is there, with respect to which we need to get the end effector position and orientation. The location of the part itself, this particular part on the table, is given by the reference frame attached to it, that is x2, y2, z2. It was attached in a particular fashion in order to make the locations of the holes, locations of the pegs on that part easily definable. I am not showing the pegs here. Now the end effector has to finally come and hold this part, right. So when the end effector is in a particular position with regard to the part, with respect to the part, the position and orientation of reference frame attached to the end effector will be as follows: x3, y3, z3. I had given the details in the last class, fine. So to start with this, we need to get the transformation between 3 and 1. Where exactly is the end effector with respect to the global reference frame x1, y1, z1. Now to look at, to specify where it has to finally go, we have this inclined plane and the inclined plane, we have fixed the reference frame to the inclined plane x4, y4, z4, starting from this particular corner of the inclined plane. Since the orientation of the inclined plane is fully known and this particular position is given, we can get the position and orientation of the fourth reference frame with respect to 1. The location of the corner, this particular corner which we call A, when finally this part is transferred here, this particular location of the corner is given here. So it can be specified with respect to this reference frame, and the orientation is along this axis. And when this reference frame 2 is in the position 5, the end effector reference frame is in the position 6. So we need to also get finally the end effector position 6 with respect to the global, fine. And remember, these transformation matrices are the 4x4 homogeneous transformation matrices, which includes the orientation information as well as the offset of the origin. Now, what would this be? We know 2 with respect to 1, right, where the part is placed with respect to the global frame, and we know 3 with respect to 2, where the end effector is with respect to the part in the first position of the end effector, right. In actually all positions of the end effector, when the end effector grips the object, this is the relationship between the end effector reference frame and the part reference frame. So, the position and orientation of the end effector is now given by multiplying these two matrices to get T3 with respect to 1. That is fairly straightforward. What about the final position of the end effector? How would you do the transformation? What is it that you know with respect to the final position? Yeah, I want some answers. Reason. From 1 to 3 I have. So I know the end effector position in the first position with respect to the global frame. Now I want the final position, which is 6. Yeah. But do you know 3 to 4? That is fine, but this is in a particular position, this in a particular position, right. So, how do you get 3 to 4? I have not actually given 4 with respect to 3 or 3 with respect to 4. Yeah, 4 with respect to 1 has been defined, right. So, actually we need to use that. We can use what you said also, because we have already got 3 with respect to 1. We know 4 with respect to 1. So, we can get 3 with respect to 4, that is possible, but directly we know 4 with respect to 1, right. So, we have 4 with respect to 1, five with respect to 4. Six with respect to 5. So this is known. This is known. What about this? Right. It is exactly the same as 3 with respect to 2. Right. So because you have gripped the part, and you haven't changed the gripping position when it is transferred from this position to this position, right. So, the gripper's reference frame with respect to the part's reference frame position has not changed. That is why these two are the same. So, it is as simple as that, fine, in notation, but the key thing is that you need to find out the elements of these matrices. In this particular case, they are fairly easily derivable. Fine. Now, if you remember the motions of manipulators that you were specifying using joint interpolation, fine. What you would use is not the initial and final position of the end effector alone. For example, now suppose I want to have the end effector move from this position to this position. These are only the final positions, the end positions. We need to now obtain all the intermediate positions. How do we solve that problem? We specify some intermediate positions and orientations also, right? Now these are specified taking care of certain things. For example, if the initial position is here and the next position is here, and the final position and the one before the final position is here and the final position is here, what would happen? It will take off, dig into the table, right? Which you don't want. You don't want collision between the objects. So in order to take care of that, the intermediate positions have to be specified appropriately. What do you want the end effector to do when it starts off? You want to make it lift off the table, right? That has to be ensured, fine. So the next position should be this x3, y3, z3 translated upwards, right? Somewhere above that. And that can be obtained by a symbol. The position of x3, y3, z3 and the new position would simply be a translation along the z3 axis with nothing else changing. You can simply translate it, right? So transformation matrix for the next position between 3 and that would be something very simple. And so you can get the transformation between that position and the part reference frame. And so the transformation which gives you the new position with respect to the global frame can also be obtained very easily. How about the position of the end effector just before you place it on the at this position? Also it has to be above, ideally above this particular plane. So that also you can obtain by translating x6, y6, z6 along z6. That is all that is required by some appropriate distance, fine. Then you can very easily get another position, and then if you translate, if you move the end effector from the first position to the slightly raised position, to the slightly raised position here and finally to this position, you expect to get a reasonable motion of the part and the robot, so that collision would not occur between the tables and the part, fine. So this is something you can do yourself, okay. Okay, now let us get to the crucial question. How do we specify position and orientation, how do we specify parameters of a mechanism when the mechanism is a complex spatial mechanism, right? You have done something like this for planar mechanisms and it was fairly easy. You had defined something called link length in planar mechanisms, right? And if there is a translating prismatic joint, then some angle is required, okay. So let us now draw a fairly complex mechanism and see how this can be done. You can start drawing after I finish, otherwise. what I've shown here are four links connected by three joints. Is that clear? So there are two revolute joints, right? There are two links connected by them. There is another link connected to this link through this revolute joint, and there is a prismatic joint here connecting this link and this link. So there are four links. So the issue now is to identify the parameters of this particular mechanism. Well, let me call this link I, and this, let this joint be joint I. So this is joint I plus 1, this is link I plus 1, this is joint this is link I plus 2, and this is joint I plus 2, and this is link, what will this link be? I minus 1. This is link I minus 1. So what we are going to discuss today are useful for serial chains. When it comes to parallel chains or links, linkages with loops, then the conventions that we are going to set up would have to be modified a little bit. Okay, so these are the joints and these are the links. You can see that these joints are not parallel or may not be perpendicular or parallel the way it is shown. If I draw the axis of the joints, this is a joint axis for this joint, for this joint you have an axis like this, and for this joint you may have an axis like this. Now what would you call link lengths? There are some lengths involved. So look for fixed parameters of this particular mechanism. What would you consider as fixed parameters, so that you will be able to use it to then determine how one link moves with respect to that. Okay, so the person who first set up a nice convention for defining link lengths was this person called Dimmenberg. Sometime in 1940s, he had a few publications where these things were defined very well. So what he proposed was the following, fairly simple. You have the physical link here, no need to consider that as the link, right? Instead of that, what can be regarded as a parameter between these two joints on this link? What is the role of the link? Remember, the link is rigid. Its role is to keep the two joints on the link in fixed relation to each other, right? So we are seeking this fixed relationship or parameters which define this fixed relationship. So if you now look at the following thing, consider the common normal between the two joints. This is a common normal between these two joints. Will that common normal shift as the link moves? Remember, the two joints are fixed on the link. So relationship between the two joints are going to remain fixed wherever the link is. So as the mechanism moves, the link moves, And as the link moves, does this distance, length of the common normal, change? It cannot. Number one. Number two, suppose you look along this particular common normal. What do you see? You see these two joint axes with a certain angle between them. These two joint axes in general are two skew lines in space, right? So when you look along the common normal, you see two lines and there will be an angle between them. Would this angle change as the link moves? That also wouldn't change, right? So these two can be two of the fixed parameters of the link, right? So for this link, we can identify two parameters. One is the length of this normal and the other is the angle between the two joints when you see along the normal. And these two parameters are called the link length and the link twist, right? It is as if the two joints are together, are parallel, and then you twist them in order to get the angle between them, and you keep it there then after that, okay. So what we have are AI and alpha I. The link length of the length and twist of link I. Fine. So if I were to do that, look at this link. Let me do it for this link. So what we have is AI here and the angle between these two. I won't clutter up the figure putting that angle there. We will see it in more detail later. This link length AI. So similarly, the common normal between this axis and this axis is the link, the representation of this link I plus 1. Fine. So let me draw that common normal. So this is A, I plus 1. Fine. Now, what about the angle between the links? We have now drawn simple representation of two links, I and I plus 1. What about the angle between them? How do we define that? Because this being a revolute pair, what changes as the mechanism moves is the angle between the links, right? Right. Look at these two segments, AI and AI plus 1. If you look along the joint, there is an angle between the two that can be regarded as the joint angle. In a revolute pair, that changes. Fine. In a revolute pair, that will change. Now, but the way we have drawn it, way we have set up, there is also a distance between these two links along this joint axis. Will that change for a revolute joint as a mechanism moves? That does not change, right? So this particular distance is called the joint offset and this angle is called the joint angle, okay. And these are called DI and theta I. These are the offset and angle of joint I. So for joint I, we have to look at the two quantities on this joint, right? What we have shown here is for joint I plus 1, but DI, the suffixes suffix I goes with joined I. Okay. So this is what Dimmenberg did. Now, if you look at a mechanism, so let me just ask one more thing here. Now, there may be a link, there may be another joined on this particular link at some other point, and there will be a joined axis over there, and the common normal between that joined axis and this axis will be the representation of that link, right. Now, along this joined also, now you can think of talk about two parameters, the joined offset and the joined angle, right. Now, as the prismatic joint moves, as this prismatic joint moves, which of these two parameters is going to change? The offset and not the angle, right. So, in a prismatic joint, the offset is the variable, whereas the angle theta is a fixed parameter, whereas for a revolute joint, the angle is a variable and the offset is a fixed parameter, fine. Whereas both the parameters associated with a link, link length and link twist are fixed, right. Now, this was what is done by Dimmenberg, and later on these people, Denavit, and Hartenberg. They set up reference frames on this mechanism, on the links, with a particular convention, and then define this link lengths and joint offsets. By the way, this is D and not alpha. They defined the link lengths, they defined how to measure these parameters, set up a convention for that, so that the signs and all those things are used consistently. So, it is useful to learn that, it is not necessary, essential that you do that. The basic concept is this, you can set up reference frames the way you want to, this is a nice convenient way of doing that, and this is called the Denavit-Hartenberg notation, which is commonly used. So, the way they set up reference frames is like this. Look at this link I. The reference frame attached to link I will have its origin on this joint. It will be simply, the x axis will be simply an extension of this link. So, draw it further and you get xi. Remember, xi, yi, zi is fixed to link I. The z axis is along this, along the joint zi, and yi is the cross product of zi and xi. I do not draw it here. So, the convention is very simple, attach the reference frame on the link at the second joint of the link, right. This is joint I plus 1, joint I. The link is between, link I is between joint I and joint I plus 1, fine. It could have been between joint I minus 1 and joint I, it really does not make much difference, fine. It is useful to stick to a convention so that you are consistent. So, xi yi is like this, and this so, similarly, we can regard that there was this particular link which had this x I minus 1 along that and z I minus 1 along the joint. So, z I minus 1 is along joint I, fine. X I minus 1 is perpendicular to that and is coincident with the link I minus 1. So, now the measurement of A I and alpha I is done like this. look at zi minus 1 and look at zi. You can translate zi minus 1 along this xi and rotate it to make zi minus 1 coincide with zi. The translation you have to do is ai and the rotation you have to do is alpha I. That is a convention. So, translation and rotation of zi minus 1 to make it coincident with zi by translating and rotating about is xi, fine. That is the direction, and rotation is in the right hand screw direction, fine. That is the positive direction. So, we, yeah. Correct. Yes. Yeah. 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 Yes. The reason is these two, zi minus 1 and zi, are perpendicular to xi. Fine. So, look along xi, you see the angle fully, full projection. So, so did you get the question? I have to repeat the question for the camera, so let me do that. The question was, can you rotate zi minus 1 about xi to make it coincident with or align with zi? It can be done because both these are perpendicular to xi, fine. So, we, so alpha I, ai and alpha I are obtained in this following fashion. Take zi minus 1 to zi along xi. Fine. So, similarly, di and theta I are defined in the following way. Translate and rotate xi minus 1. We are talking about di and theta I, so associated with joint I, fine. So, translate and rotate xi minus 1 about zi minus 1 to make it coincident with xi, right. The convention is the right hand screw direction. So, we take xi minus 1 to xi along so, this is the convention that is used, and we set up reference frames like this. So, there will be a reference frame attached to link I plus 1. So, it will have its origin here, and the x I plus 1 axis is the extension of this. And so, what is the z I plus 1 axis? Along joint I, joint I plus 1, right. Joint I plus 2, along joint I plus 2. So, fine. So, this is the convention that we are going to use. We are going to set up reference frames like this and define the mechanism parameters like this for a robot, and then with that, after that, we can do the inverse and forward kinematics in a systematic fashion, okay. So, some points associated with what we now did is, let me put it back here and ask. I had directed zi along this direction. Is that the only possibility? It is not. It could have been in the opposite direction, right. To start with, the joint does not have a direction, fine. Unless it is a helical joint, then you can define some direction. Otherwise, a revolute joint does not have a direction, okay. It has a sense, it has a, I mean, it, there is a direction in space associated with that, without it is It could be in one of two directions. Similarly, the prismatic joint. But the prismatic joint has even one more thing which is not really well determined with regard to this. Why did I put the prismatic joint through this particular position in space? What is special about that? In a revolute joint, there is a specific axis about which one link rotates with respect to the other. In a prismatic joint, there is only a direction. There is no particular axis through which, along which a prismatic joint translates. I could have put it as well out here, right? Provided I made in the direction properly. So, the axis of a prismatic joint can actually be located anywhere provided the direction is correct. So, we locate it conveniently. So, let me note down those points for you. So, any one of two directions would do. So, choose anything convenient. Anything would do. It does not have to be associated with that physical piston and cylinder that is out there, fine, or a slide and a guide and slide which is out there. Suppose on a link, it is a binary link, which means there are two joints. The two joints are parallel. Then where would you put the common normal? There are an infinity of common normals, right? Again, choose something convenient, right? So, choose conveniently. Just one more thing. In a robot, are all the links binary links? A industrial manipulator is typically a serial chain, right? So, most of the links are binary. There are two links which are not binary, the base and the end effector, right? What type of links are they? They have just one joint each, right? Whereas our convention for setting up reference frames use two joints on a link. So, how do you set up reference frames on links when there is just one axis? So, take a base link. So, this is base. Suppose there is an axis on this. This is joint 1. So z naught is along this. What about x naught? X naught, z naught, y naught. This is fixed to link, the first link, right? So this will be link 0 by our convention. It could be anywhere along this. Take something perpendicular to this, that is all. Fine, that is all that is required. Similarly, consider the last link. Right, there is a last joint associated with that. And already we have set up z n minus 1 some let us say x n minus 1. We have to set up the reference frame x n, y n, z n to this link, the last link. How do we do that? Choose arbitrarily any point for the origin of the reference frame, right? Drop a perpendicular to the z n minus 1 axis from that point and then choose this as x n. Anything perpendicular to that can be z n, fine. It may not be chosen like this, it may be more convenient, but we could align it with this if we want to, fine. So this is all that we have to take care of. There more freedom is available to us in how to fix this particular, these reference frames, okay. So this is some of the points we need to remember. Now let us take up the sixth revolute Puma, fine. That is in a sense one of the more complicated manipulators, and then set up these reference frames, define these linkage parameters, and then after that do the forward and inverse kinematics, fine. Let me start this off. So I will first draw Puma. I am drawing it roughly, it is not important that you be able to draw this particular figure. So if you remember what the Puma is, this there is a vertical pose. Have you gone to robotics lab and seen this, the Puma? You have seen rhino. Okay, there is this vertical post. So this link, this is the second link, base link, second link, rotates about the base link about a vertical axis. Fine. Then there is a horizontal axis here about which this link rotates. It's like our shoulder. Okay. Then there is another axis again horizontal, which remains always horizontal, about which this rotates with respect to this. So this is like the shoulder and this is like the elbow, right? So this is like our upper arm and this is like the forearm. Fine. So that makes up what is called the regional structure. The orientational part of the mechanism is this particular wrist, which is something like this. About this axis, this whole thing can rotate, and then there is another axis here about which this can rotate, and finally the gripper, the end effector, can rotate about an axis like this. So there are three axes. I will show it in more detail later. There are three axes about which the end effector can rotate. Right? So this somewhat like the puma. Now let us see how to set up the reference frames for this. So something which is useful to do when you set up reference frames is to imagine the robot in a special position, in a special configuration. It will be fairly easy to figure out how to fix the axis if you actually stretch out puma, right? Then all these axes, their relative positions and all that can be fairly easily represented on the paper. Otherwise the problem is if you put it in some odd position, it is very difficult to represent it in space. Okay. So ideally let the, see, with Dimenberg's convention of using common normals between axes in order to represent the link, you will see that a serial chain is made up of a sequence of segments in space which are adjacent ones are perpendicular to each other, right. So you have the link, you have the joint offset which is perpendicular to that, you have the next link which is perpendicular to that joint offset, you have the next offset which is perpendicular to that particular link, and it goes on like that in a sequence. It's possible in many cases, especially in the case of puma, to align these offsets and joint axes along some global x, y, and z directions. So, if you do that, drawing that and conceiving it becomes simple, right? So, we'll do that. I represent the first revolute joint by the cylinder. Fine, its axis is vertical. The next one is parallel to this. So, another cylinder which is parallel to that. And I stretch out the whole thing along this axis direction. So the next one is out here. Further along this, so I have actually the three axes already drawn. One is the vertical axis, the two horizontal axes. Third one is a rotation about this longitudinal direction. Fine. So I have an axis like this now. Fine. And then further along that, there is this particular axis which stretched out like this turns out to be parallel to this, and then further along this there is a third axis for the wrist which is like this. These are the six joint axes. Fine, in a particular stretched out position of the puma. Okay, so I'll call this joint 1, joint 2, joint 3, joint 4, joint 5, and joint 6. So imagine that these joints are now frozen in space like this, and now set up the reference frames. It will turn out that many of the link lengths are 0 when you do that, but anyway, set up the reference frames and then we will list out what the various parameters are. Fine, we don't have time for that today. We'll do it tomorrow.